particles that are moving actually in straight lines. This might actually seem weird at first, but that something moving in a straight line can have angular momentum. Right? It's not rotating, it's not spinning. Right? But if you're thinking about the angular momentum of, around any point, around any axis, that's not along the path of the thing going in a straight line, it's going to have some kind of angular momentum. The one way I've seen this explained to try to get a picture in your head of what that means is to imagine that you're standing in place and you represent the axis. Right? You're the axis that you want to say what is rotating around you. Right? And then someone walks by in a straight line. Right? From your perspective, if you wanted to watch them do that and follow, right, you have to turn from your head to follow them. And so that means you're basically sitting when you do that. Right? And that's the rotation. So in some sense, the person who's going by you does rotate around you. Right? Even though from sort of an outside perspective, they're going in a straight line. We can also go ahead and see this directly by looking at collisions where angular momentum has to be conserved. So if we go to this other video. Okay. So in this video, there's a setup where there's a board that's, again, it's not a turntable, but it's on an axle, so it can spin. And you roll a ball towards it in a straight line. They collide, right? And the ball is straight and it actually bounces back straight. But when it does that, it gives a rotation to the board. Right? So it starts, the board has no angular momentum, right? And after, it's going to have some because it's spinning. Right? And that angular momentum comes from the collision with the ball. But because the whole thing is conserving angular momentum, right, we're ignoring all the frictions, and that means that you don't have a torque from anything, gravity's in the wrong direction, right, the normal force holding the ball up is in the wrong direction. That means the ball actually had to have angular momentum to start with. It had to have some angular momentum that it could essentially give to the board by applying a torque to it. Because right? You're going to get a torque from the force of the collision. Right? That torque around the axle is going to cause different suspension. And like I said, I know this is basically, it seems like a really weird, unintuitive thing that something going straight actually has angular momentum. But for now, I think maybe you're. If that's not convincing enough for you, I think we'll just have to go and try to accept it, and maybe it's one of those things that it clicks later. And I know this one's a little bit weird. Okay. We also need to know how to actually find it, right, in terms of the number, how much angular momentum it has, right? Because it's not moving around in a circular path, so it's a little weird, right, to define and omega for it. You can't really do that easily. So there's really two ways to find what this angular momentum is. And I put on the slide the one that I think is the easiest. If you imagine the thing sort of moving in a straight line, back into the past, forward into the future, that makes a long line. And if you find the point on that line where you get the closest to the axis, then there's a distance from the axis to that point, and that's this r for r perpendicular. It's an r, because the closest point is where you get a perpendicular 90-degree angle between the line and the velocity and the distance from that point to the axis. Right, so that's r perpendicular. And I can draw out how you can do this the other way. So instead of thinking about the v perpendicular, so these are sort of the two ways to get at the angular momentum. to think about how to do the calculation. Right? So in one, you say here's the axis, and then this has some z that you extrapolate. Right, and then this is r perpendicular. Or same thing. There's my v. The other way to do this is to think about the perpendicular v. So that means you find the r for the, where the point is right now. Right, so where you've actually drawn it, then you use this as one of the axes for a coordinate system, like we talked about, right, when we were doing all the motion and forces and stuff. So you make a coordinate system, and you find a component of v along the perpendicular direction. So this is v perpendicular. Right. And if you sit down and do out the details of the math, the product of these two, v times r perpendicular, is equal to v perpendicular times r. So it doesn't matter which one you do. Right? It just really depends on what the angle between the two is, r and v. Right? And then if you just multiply these by m, then you get the momentum. So you get mv. As we go forward in doing the problem, we have some time to think about, we'll be doing ones where you have different angles. But let's just do the qualitative picture first. And so we have a few poles here. Okay. So in all these questions, there is going to be a ball, the same ball with the same mass, and with the same magnitude of velocity, moving in a straight line, but we're going to like move around where the ball is relative to the axis and things like that. Okay. So the first question is, in this setup, the ball is moving in a straight line right at the axis. What's its angular momentum? In terms of positive and negative, I'm going to say let's treat counterclockwise as positive. So clockwise, so from the top to the right to down to the left, that's clockwise, that's negative. Take a little bit more time if you're still thinking. Alright, so yeah, the most popular response is B, which is zero. Good, that's the right one. Right? So the object is going straight at the x. Right? So in terms of our different ways to think about it, right, you could say in one case, oh well, in the future, what's the closest it gets to the axis? Well, it gets to the axis, so that r perpendicular is zero. Right? So it doesn't matter what b is, you get zero, which then goes to the axis. And then the other way, you could draw line from the x to the ball right now and say, oh, well, v is just parallel to that line, right? So the perpendicular perpendicular component of V is zero. So that means you have no angle. Clear. Okay. Next question. Okay, so what if the axis is in a different spot? Right? So same ball moving horizontally to the right, but the axis is now down a bit. What about the angular momentum now? Is it positive? Is it still zero, or is it positive or negative? A little bit more time if you need it. Okay, 3, 2, 1. Okay, so the majority thinks that it's not zero anymore, which is good, right? Because now, if you extrapolate it, right, there is some radius there, some distance between the axis and the point, if they never get to the same spot. So it's right that it's not zero anymore. Right? But is it positive or negative? Right? So again, this is about you need to pick, and I decided to pick that counterclockwise was positive, so you have to think about the sense in which this thing is moving. So it's not actually going around in a circle, right, like the hands of the clock. But if you look at it, it's going sort of from left to right over the top. Right? So if you did imagine that instead of going in a straight line, it would start to turn, like orbiting the Earth, right, it would go around from the top to the right, to the bottom, to the left, back to the top, right, that's clockwise. And so since that rotation sense is clockwise, when we say counterclockwise is positive, that means that this is negative. So C was the right answer, which was also the plurality there. That's good. So just be careful, right? And again, for a particular problem, you can pick which way you want to be positive, but the important thing is that if you have more than one object spinning or moving in a straight line around the axis, you need to be consistent and clear which sense you pick, right? So that if one thing is moving clockwise and the other thing is moving counterclockwise, one of them needs to be positive and the other needs to be negative. Okay, now what if I take the same object, but I just change the angle of its velocity in that picture, right? So the same magnitude, but you just change the angle. Does that change whether its angular momentum is positive, negative, or zero? negative is the overwhelmingly popular answer, and that's right. Because the situation is basically the same, you just change the angle, so you're still going around in the same sense, around the thing, and it's not zero because you're not pointed right at it. Okay. But something is different, right? So the next question is this situation, is the magnitude of the angular momentum greater, the same, or less than the one that was moving horizontal? Right? So between this and this, same mass, same magnitude of the velocity, different direction of the velocity relative to the x. So this one, and then this one, where it points down a bit. And again, we're talking about the magnitude of the angular momentum, so don't get tripped up about the fact that they're negative, and which is, is the absolute value, right? Greater, the same, or less. That's a good one. Yeah, take your time on this one. Draw some pictures. Try to think about how you figure out how to do this. Just do a little bit more time if you need it. The majority is in agreement that it's not the same anymore. So that's good, right? Something changed that affects the way you get the angular momentum. But we're pretty split on whether it gets bigger or smaller. Right? So why don't we go through this again in detail in terms of the pictures. Right? And basically, I'm going to draw this similar to before. So there's my axis. And over here, I have a similar thing, and we'll try to put this about the same spot. It's a bit magnitude of V, but it's going down a bit. Well, I like to do it this way, where I extrapolate where this is going. Right, and I find that R perpendicular, right, when you get a 90 degree angle here. And since the V's are the same, I just need to see if the R perpendicular is bigger or smaller. Right, so this one I do the extrapolation. Right, and now my R perpendicular is here. This R perpendicular is a lot smaller than that one. Right? Since the magnitude of the velocity is the same, we can V times R perpendicular, we'll get a smaller, then times N, we get a smaller angular momentum. Right? The closer you get to the axis. Right? So the one that comes closer to the axis has a smaller angular momentum. get into the details of the angles, but it's, I think it's important to have that qualitative picture first, if it's smaller or bigger. Yeah, so again, just a few more points about, you know, the choice of the axis, right? Because I drew an X on the page, and that basically said this is going to be the axis for this problem. But you don't have to, you can do problems with other choices. An axis, in that case, that was just an X on the sheet. It wasn't actually a physical thing. And so the angular momentum does depend on the choice of axis, right? Because if I just pick that the axis was long, the path of the particle, you have zero angle. This is okay. This is just means that the sort of intermediate math is different. The physical answer that you get to a problem won't depend on your choice. How something is going to move, where it's going to go, what is it going to hit, right? That can't depend just on where you decided to put an imaginary line. But this is especially true actually next week when we start doing torque and equilibrium problems. Usually one choice is going to be easier than another. And I think for angular momentum, it will usually be pretty obvious which one you should pick. Right? Because most of them are going to involve some object that's actually fixed, right? So a literal axle, right? So a literal axis of rotation. And in that case, that's what you're going to want to pick, right? If you pick anything else, you're just going to make your life harder because now you have to worry about all sorts of different angular momentum, and that's going to suddenly, now that then other forces that